automatically the referrals go in, and pretty much everyone gets referred to us, and then we find, then our referral coordinator will find who may not, who potentially can be involved with us, and then we help them figure out where they need to go before they're discharged. And then also in the emergency department, our patients who come in with new clots, they don't need to be admitted, so we want to get the patients educated and discharged. And so the, there are emergency department pharmacists that can assist with that. Currently, the way that ED works is if they, if the DOAC is appropriate, then they'll have our outpatient pharmacy run a test claim. They're just right down the hall, so outpatient pharmacy is really great at helping run claims. And then we can see the cost, and if it's appropriate, we send them out. If it's middle of the night, then perhaps the, they'll park the patient in the hallway until the pharmacy opens, and then the pharmacy will run claims and check on costs. A lot of times, if the cost is too much, there are, and I mentioned before, the manufacturer ones that can hold the patient over for a month, but again, with that same issue with transitioning care, we want to make sure the patient is actually followed up after the month. So if they are a UC Davis, they have a UC Davis provider, they can come back to our clinic or the provider, and they can get followed up. But if it's patient who's unfunded, they are just, we educate them to make sure they go to the clinic so that they can have follow-up, and if the DOAC is appropriate, then they might have to switch that to another agent. So. And then, so again, with the, all the issues that I mentioned here, at UC Davis, we try to answer all these questions just to make sure that it's appropriate, DOACs are appropriate for the patient, and that they have no cost issues, and that they have the appropriate follow-up. There are some resources that we do utilize at UC Davis just to make it a little bit easier for everybody, since there are a lot of questions that come up about the DOACs. And we have an anticoagulation website that's accessible on the internet and internet. So any questions about dosing, patient booklets, contact information, clinic policies, everything's available for providers to pull up on their computer, and then they can get the information that they need. Again, patient educational handouts that I mentioned before, we have them available for all our DOACs as well as all our brochures in multiple languages. So that's available. Sometimes I'm seeing patients in clinic, we don't have them, I just jump on them and print it out, so it's really helpful. Our Epic system is set up to send a best practice alert to our anticoagulation inbox, so that anybody who has warfarin or a DOAC on their medication profile, if the latter is, if the other one is ordered, we get an alert. And so that's how we find a lot of our patients who are being switched to DOAC private providers. And so our pharmacists will contact the patient, make sure that they have appropriate follow-up instructions, and know how to make the transition. Because again, a lot of times there is some confusion, and if the instructions they were given don't seem quite appropriate, we may intervene and discuss with the patient. And again, an anticoagulation specialist, both outpatient and inpatient, have been vital in assisting providers with making changes and making sure candidates are appropriate. So some ongoing issues at UC Davis, so just specifically with the DOAC clinic, it has been about 2 years since we started this clinic, and it really is just embedded within our anticoagulation clinic. So when we first started out, we were thinking the same as everybody else. We make sure the DOAC is right, correct, we get the patient on it, we'll follow up with them. So we're like, okay, it takes us maybe about 10 minutes to talk to a patient about the IR, so we assume with the DOAC patient, we would be talking to them maybe 5 to 10, same amount of time. So we didn't hire any new pharmacists. We absorbed the DOAC patients into our current workload. And then as I was calling these patients and working with them, I realized that they do actually spend a lot of time with these patients. And so just the initial education, when we first get the referral, we do a full education, at least 20 to 30 minutes, talking to the patient about what it is, how it's different from warfarin, if they weren't warfarin, what anticoagulation means. Making dosing adjustments. And so we found that a lot of times we had to slightly adjust the dose if they were not adjusted correctly. get anything going again in 3 months. But then they potentially could go up to 45 minutes, depending on what the issue is. Sometimes patients have procedures all the time, so we'll review the procedure with them and then figure out what they have to do, and then we have to follow up with the patient, make sure they have all the same instructions. Cost issues, again, come up frequently for patients. So the time spent with the patients has been longer than we anticipated, so that's something our clinic is trying to figure out as we move forward to see how to efficiently work with these patients. So that kind of comes back to some other questions. We're deciding how often should the clinic be in contact. When we call the patients, a lot of them are told, please don't need monitoring. They're like, why are you calling me? They don't know. Because they're told, you don't need to hear from anybody or go to lab again. And so when they're calling, the patients who are very stable, we're trying to figure out if there's certain patients that need to be called more often than other patients. So we're kind of working through that. And then the next question is, right now we follow all the patients who are on warfarin in the health system. Should we monitor all the patients on DOAX? And again, we don't have any extra FTEs for that. We have just our current staff, and that's kind of the next step in our clinic as we move forward with monitoring these patients. And so just a quick recap. So whenever DOAX is initiated, definitely need to consider patient characteristics when you're initiating to make sure it's fully appropriate. DOAX patients do need monitoring throughout therapy, so it is anticoagulant, so there are bleeding issues, there's compliance issues, so we definitely want to follow up on that. There's no INR anymore, so we won't know if the patient is taking their medication, so we definitely want to be following patients long-term throughout therapy. And then consider cost of long-term management when transitioning a patient from the hospital or emergency room to outpatient. So there's a lot of areas where a patient can fall through the cracks and end up back in the emergency room again. And then if there's a way to offer providers resources to assist with prescribing and monitoring DOAX, I think that would be really helpful. There's each of the DOAX manufacturer websites have a lot of information. If you have an anticoagulation team that you can reach out to, that can utilize resources. I have some discussion questions here, unless there's other questions. Yes?
Quick question. I just had to think about, how the anticoagulants work and therapy and surgery. You talked about procedures, and sometimes that needs to change. Are there any contraindications to pain medications that might interfere? So, for instance, NSAIDs or aspirin. What's the preferred pain therapy for someone on these new DOACs? Could you expand on that just a little bit?
Yeah, good question. That actually comes up a lot because everyone's aware of warfarin, no NSAIDs. So you just wanted to know if there's any special issues relating to pain medications, so NSAIDs, aspirin, with the DOACs. And so I actually had a discussion with our medical director about this, and he said, yes, anytime you're on an anticoagulant, you don't want any agent that may potentially cause a GI bleed. And so what we tell our patient is we do want you to avoid NSAIDs and aspirin, unless prescribed for cardiac reasons. And we prefer acetaminophen for our patients just because of that potential GI bleed.
Thank you.
Quick question. So you're spending a fair amount of time, up to 45 minutes with these individuals in a clinic. Are you billing for that and getting reimbursed for that? Or who picks up the cost of the extra pharmacist time?
So right now, our clinic is funded through internal medicine, so we don't get any extra billing or any extra funds from these phone calls. And so, again, as we move forward, we're reevaluating how we want to manage the patients because we are pretty much just squeezing the patients into our current workload and our day at this point.
So what does it cost the healthcare system to provide this service when you're not getting reimbursed? What's your annual cost?
That I would have to look into.
sense that Ybarra could say a word about the reimbursement on the Medi-Cal side. Is it an 85% change in law that Steve Chen was mentioning?
Mary, do you remember the...
You should be sitting up here with us. Yeah. Dr. Jessica Nunez de Ybarra, for those of you who don't know her, is one of the lead physicians for the state of California at the Department of Public Health and is doing very, very creative and important work in medication management. So she's leading the charge to make sure that pharmacists get reimbursed for this important work.
So the way that I'm doing that, again, I'm from the California Department of Public Health, is to bring a core team of leaders, some of which are here today, Dr. Fermerson, Hattie, others, including Stephen Chen at the University of Southern California School of Pharmacy. Stephen is working similarly, as you've heard this morning, with his historic funding by CMMI, award for comprehensive medication management, and in his work to implement better solutions for outpatient care of patients, he has informed us that in LA County, it was clear to one entity working in the mental health space that many times their therapies require a pharmacist level type of oversight. And in LA County, one of the jurisdictions understood that California law currently puts pharmacists as providers for certain medications. And when the county of LA or this entity in LA County wanted to reimburse its pharmacists for their assistance in helping these patients, they were told that they would have to basically flip the switch for the reimbursement provision of that provider, basically at the county level for mental health services. And apparently that just happened in LA County, where they are now reimbursing pharmacists that help with mental health issues. And what I'll do is I will have Stephen write it up so that we can communicate to the rest of this group those details. Because the thought is that this particularly very motivated provider of mental health services in LA County was able to, through basically an administrative procedure, get funding to flow to reimburse in that system. And so we're very excited about that. Recently just found out about that provision last week, right?
Friday.
Yeah. So things are happening. I want to be clear with you all, though, that you know what we're hearing today are lots of important elements. You all have to figure out the cost, as has been described, you know, the time, that administrative detail. I'm very interested in how y'all are putting your teams together, because we're also going to try and look to see if we could extend the work of the pharmacist so that maybe the pharmacist isn't working on the billing side, or, you know, we've heard about the hospice nurses that are also, you know, like each group is, you know, that inpatient enterprise was, again, high level physician power, hospitalists, you know, we're thinking about outpatient support with maybe a more hands on the deck to support these very expensive leaders, per se, of these teams. So we'll be circling back, but I will get that information to y'all, because that may be something you'll be able to do, or at least for you all to know, because essentially things are changing.
Questions? Discussion? Comments?
I have a question. How many pharmacists are in the program?
So currently in our outpatient clinic, we have 5.5
for a patient load of 2,000.
For 2,000. And we also, besides anticoagulation, some of us cross-train into controlled substance.
just one quick question on heart failure, since we still have Dr. Kathleen Tong with us. You talked about the different options for anticoagulation. Is there a preference of the medication choices for heart failure patients?
From what I've seen, there's nothing that really, there's not one that's preferred over the other.
I preferentially use Eliquis because I like the pharmacokinetics of it better. The drug levels are more.
Could you repeat that with the microphone, please?
And I'm not on your speaker here, but I preferentially use Eliquis because I like, even though it's twice a day dosing, most of my patients are already on medications twice a day, so it doesn't really add complexity to the medication regimen. And probably it's anecdotal, but we've seen a couple of bad bleeds on rivaroxaban, which maybe due to how the drug peaks really high and goes really low, where the Eliquis tends to be a little bit more stable. We have a lot of patients who respond to warfarin as well because of creatinine clearance and other things.
Thank you very much.
Okay. If there are no other questions, let's give them.